Today, I'm going to be talking about guilds. Not many people will remember at this point, but at the Heart of Thorns announcement, one of the biggest things that the community had in general been asking for, and met with raucous applause, were guild halls, and general guild-based features. Well, that's what ArenaNet gave us with the expansion. But the question, as always, how did it really go? I was wary about such a feature myself in the early days. Most people asking for it, I felt, were fueled mostly by Guild Wars 1 nostalgia. But just like with most nostalgia-fueled requests we might make, it's easy to forget or overrepresent just how worthwhile those things once upon a time were. But people really wanted guild halls. No, it's easy to forget. People seriously cared about this.
And that takes us to our final major feature of Guild Wars 2 Heart of Thorns. I think you've all been waiting a long time to hear this one. Guild Halls. So what is a guild hall in Guild Wars 2? It seems like you guys might like that one a little bit.
Well, with Heart of Thorns, guilds did get that big update, and it's not just the beautiful new halls that they added, but much more too. They're pretty important to look at these days, especially considering the heightened potential for drama with all the in-game currency and money that can be dumped into guilds. So, let's talk about them. The first thing we should really establish are my qualifications to speak on this topic. I'll explain this of myself. For those who don't know, I actually formed a guild after Heart of Thorns came out. I didn't have much of a history as a guild leader before the expansion, but after I certainly do. I did this, mind you, as well a couple of months after release, which means I missed out on a lot of drama and economic issues and things at the exact launch. We'll get into that later. But understand this, I have personally overseen and specifically myself activated every single upgrade that ArenaNet had designed for guilds and guild halls. I've watched every donation of gold or items come into my community, and I've played very close attention to what everything cost, what the motivation of my members were, how happy we've been, and so forth. The reason I did this was because, generally speaking, it's very difficult to assess the balance of guilds in Guild Wars 2 of today. A lot of it's crowdfunded stuff, and because few players will ever be in a position to know how crowdfunded stuff looks from the top, I wanted to get that perspective. You tend to find that people, when they talk about guild halls in Guild Wars 2 of today, they say it's too expensive, but it's because they have the mind frame of their own pocket rather than the pockets of 50 people, or 100, 200, or even 500. So I've made this effort to hopefully have an informed opinion. So let's jump in. Let's first deal with just the smaller things that came with Heart of Thorns outside of guild halls. And the first thing I would say that guilds in general, let's be real, are in pretty much the same place as they were before the expansion came out. The lifeblood of guild activity, guild missions, which people tried to run once every week, have had some updates and did have some tweaks with Heart of Thorns that I much appreciated, but really didn't get enough focus since they were first dropped in, and we haven't had enough totally new varieties or new puzzles and the sort placed into the game to really infuse that life back into them. Large communities such as my own are still gated in the same ways we were in 2012, like having a 500 player cap, and various quality of life improvements still haven't come into the game, like being able to assign someone a rank at the exact moment you invite them, or to be able to monitor player representation and activity in more concrete ways. Features like that might be a little divisive, but generally would be useful and still aren't there even after Heart of Thorns. The devs, in terms of development, seem to have drawn a line in the sand and said, okay, we'll work on guild stuff while making an expansion, but in the times between expansions, all those living world days, you're not gonna get much in the way of updates. They're content to put new decorations in, and sometimes a small upgrade to a hall, but that's about our lot. I think we'll be waiting several months until the next expansion to see how much further they push the system, and until then, it's kind of like we're still in 2012. To get a bit more nitty and gritty about this, one big and positive change that we do tend to forget and we do tend to take for granted, but nonetheless was a part of Heart of Thorns, is Alliance Chat. Or what we colloquially know as Alliance Chat. This is the ability to type to people in guilds that you're not currently representing and to be able to see everything they're saying again, even though you're not representing them. That may not have been a ridiculously huge shift as some of us speculated. I myself was excited at the prospect of market-based guilds rising up in lieu of this. And while we quite haven't got that far, probably because of the 500 player cap I just mentioned, it has nonetheless been a pretty great boon to the community currently still there in Guild Wars 2. The game genuinely does seem a lot more active because of Alliance Chat, and I do think we would do well to remember that was a part of Heart of Thorns. Guild Anthems were another feature that often goes under the radar. It's funny too, because like so many Heart of Thorns features, such as raiding and the Fractal's backpack and legendary weapons or even legendary armor, the Anthems system did genuinely arrive much later than it was first anticipated. But there was no community backlash on this one. Anthems are a feature whereby you can select a tune to represent your guild from a list and will play at special occasions, such as when you win a PvP match. For me, aside from when I have been messing about with a special finisher they put in the game and spamming this audio in the guild hall, this is really not a feature I've interfaced with too much, and I don't think many players even think about it much anymore. Perhaps if World vs. World and team-based PvP were more successful formats in Guild Wars 2, we'd see a lot more discussion and reflection on this feature on the part of the community, but since I'm really not into those areas of the game that much, I find myself not caring too much about Anthems. Speaking of guild features to fly under the radar and PvP, there is another thing too, and those are guild teams. This is another part of Heart of Thorns that I very rarely, if ever, look at. Of the six significant PvP seasons to have released for that area of the game since Heart of Thorns, I have participated in five of them, securing myself several pretty respectable placements. I have thousands of PvP matches under my belt after Heart of Thorns is over. I'm a guild leader that runs a guild whereby any of my players could have formed a team and played together, and despite all of this, I've seen no one really use the feature, especially not since the PvP seasons don't even really allow for full-size teams anymore. This is really a part of the game that didn't end up going anywhere. And tied to this too are the PvP-based trophies. We'll be talking a lot more about scribing and trophies coming up shortly, but for this specific section of the game, I don't think anyone really sees the incentive. I've never heard or spoken to anyone who really genuinely tried to collect those trophies, and again, you can't even do it anymore since the format went to solo duo queue. And that's all I really have to say on the general guild improvements. They're kind of small, fluffy things, some have been worthwhile, some have not, but in general, guilds feel about the same as they did to me in 2012. They haven't really done any damage to the game, mind you, but nothing accents this part of Guild Wars 2 like I kind of want there to be. I mean, this is Guild Wars, right? As pathetic as that semantic argument about the title of the game is, I really would value anything that helps people form meaningful connections and communities in the game. And maybe, though guilds are pretty good, they still have a long way to go in that department. I guess we'll be waiting on the next expansion to see that. Now, you'll notice that this is a pretty long video, and that's because I want to shift gears now to the main point, our main talking area, and oh boy, is it a complicated and nuanced feature, guild halls. And it's a part of the game that I feel I've come to understand extremely well.
A guild hall in Guild Wars 2 is much more than what it's been in the past.
First thing to say about the addition of guild halls to Guild Wars 2 is this. they are generally not used very much. They are enormous and beautiful maps that have pushed the graphical capabilities of Guild Wars 2 forwards, in keeping with the expansion in general. If you'd like a complete tour of a fully upgraded hall, the Lost Precipice that I made, there's actually a link on screen to that right now. And what you will see is absolutely stunning. These places look brilliant, and it's great that the devs put that effort into these places to try and encourage players to want to hang out in them a lot. However, all of this praise cannot avoid one sad truth, that aside from being gorgeous to look at, there's little incentive for players to explore these massive locations. Guild Halls have not been a game changer for Guild Wars 2, and have not been the landmark feature that they could have been. But what's interesting though, is that I think ArenaNet really did go above and beyond with the halls. They added a mission to capture them, they added upgrade features, they added an entirely new crafting discipline, and a crap ton of currencies and items to support Guild Halls. Guild Halls in Guild Wars 2 are a lot deeper than Guild Halls in Guild Wars 1 by a huge margin. The result is that, to me, it's a huge shame they haven't lived up to their potential. Yes, only two halls were introduced with Heart of Thorns, and we probably wanted a selection of more. Fan favourites of mine suggest Claw Island, Cordicus's Manor, or having a guild hall in the Mists, but that only scratches the surface of why halls and all the systems that came with them may not have lived up. And that's what we're going to be exploring here. First, let's talk about upgrades. So, the upgrade system is one of the core aspects of Guild Halls that came in with Heart of Thorns. This was something that never existed in GW1 in any form, but is an interesting extension to the idea of a community that has progression together. With Heart of Thorns, all the guilds in the game were assigned a level. This is essentially another form of progress or prestige you can work towards. You can show it off to the world as a sign that your guild is a badass guild that has hit max guild level. To increase your guild level, you must capture a hall from the enemy. For Heart of Thorns, this is the Mordrum, and the suspicion is it might be to do with other dragon minions in future expansions. And once you've captured your hall from the enemy, you're going to upgrade it from a ruin into a fully functioning base of operations. The total time it takes to finish upgrading everything is, I think, pretty well balanced, clocking in at around 9 months for your community to get to the end. Now, that 9 months is for my, at the time, reasonably inactive guild, and though it may sound like a ridiculously long time to you, don't misinterpret this. I think that the longer, the better for guild halls. See, for as long as your group of players, your guild, has a collective goal to continue working towards, a building to refurbish or a new NPC to unlock, there's some fun to be had and meaning to what you're doing in the game. Hitting the end of that line and finally capping the hall out can feel like suddenly the hall has lost a lot of what made it fun, that there'll be no more of these special moments where a cutscene triggers and you get to see a building grow, or you'll have some new dialogue from some new NPC. It's like the end of a great TV show. You were looking forward to the finale, but when you actually get there, you're going to be sad that there were no new episodes. It's true that in the years since Heart of Thorns came out, ArenaNet have added other new upgrades that let you keep building even after the original end of progression. For example, Guild Anthems, which we just talked about before, weren't there at launch, but when they came later, guilds could level up that bit higher. We've also seen new items be added to the War Room, and new materials manifest at the workshop. This is something I quite like in principle, but while these have all served as opportunities for guilds to continue increasing their levels, currently 69 is the max, and to keep getting bonuses, none have been as significant as what we saw when Heart of Thorns first came out, like entire new buildings to refurbish. Pre-launch talk of possible new buildings being dropped in with later patches are a really great idea that the devs were keen on, but as of yet, they've never added a new building to a guild hall. 12 months, 9 months, or 6 months, depending on how motivated a guild might be, it is inevitable that many groups will eventually max out their halls. This happened for a large number of guilds long before I maxed out mine. Even very small guilds have, through sheer grit and determination, made it to the end of this progression system. Pre-launch, ArenaNet talked about the upgrades being balanced to be possible with just a 10-man player roster, the smallest of the smallest, and once the economy had settled down, I generally find sign that their comments there have been true. 10-man groups can max out a guild hall, they just have to put the effort in. Back with the initial economic turbulence at release, however, certain currencies got really bloated, and there were definite lashings from peoples who only had small guilds and felt like they'd been lied to, because guild progression, right as Half-Thorns came out, cost just so damn much. Since that time, and particularly the expansion 2.0 patch, which made most things dead easy to get, things are still tough, but significantly easier, and I don't think newcomers today should be scared or feel the same way at all. It just depends on how bad you want it. Whether it's really rewarding to finish the whole progression of this guild system, I'm a little unsold on. Particularly, I find the guild level idea fell kind of flat. It's a nice indicator of progress when comparing my 5 different guilds together, but make no mistake, it doesn't mean much beyond that. And it's particularly due to the fact so many guilds are already max level, so it's nothing noteworthy. In this way, I feel that like the guild system and its levels are a lot like masteries. It's not the same as a race to world first level 80 back at the core game's launch, or in other MMOs where they increase player combat levels with the expansions and everyone races to see who will get to the end. I suspect that the number of guilds in the very early days who were racing through upgrades as fast as possible to see who would get to the end first and were getting competitive about their level is very small. If existent at all, and without some kind of optional PvE league system that resets guild progress every now and then so that people can compete again, there's absolutely zero space for that in the future of Guild Wars 2 either. So guild levels are just kind of a fun number you look at, and not much else. As an aside to all of this, another pre-launch idea was that of the guild crystal. As guild halls leveled up and the number of guild members increases, you have a crystal at your guild hall that's supposed to react and grow. This is true, it does do that, but it's largely something you ignore and you're never quite directed to it after the initial mission when you claim your hall. It's not something I think that anyone was that interested in, given how gradual guild hall progress is. Maybe these crystals will do something at level 80, which we currently can't get to, but for now, the Guildhall crystal has not been what it was first suggested to be. I struggle finding any reasonable way these crystals can integrate them into the story of Guild Wars 2 at all, for that matter. Reaching max guild level felt satisfying to me, but it didn't unlock a mission like the initial one to capture the hall, it didn't affect the crystal, and it didn't act as some intense reward. There is the concept of a guild who does no progression and has no hall. ArenaNet went to great lengths before Heart of Thorns came out to discuss this idea and fully support it. That's funny because guilds like this really aren't a thing in the end. These would be guilds who are exclusively free-to-play players, I guess, or core game-only people. And for this narrow demographic, the developers built the beautiful Guild Hall Initiative building in Lion's Arch. It's funny looking back because it really is a lovely place with a peculiar secret bookshelf that reveals a redundant hidden area and more, but honestly, I don't think I've ever encountered a person who uses it as the devs thought people might before launch. Nobody uses the Lion's Arch area as their guild hall, do they? Perhaps players who have guilds just for solo banks might care about this area of the game, but I find myself exploring it these days and wishing it was more integrated into the system beyond the very odd visit here and there. So that's how the guild level and maxing out your progression ended up feeling to me. A minor and nice addition. Not the thing to focus on. What's more important are the upgrades you get themselves, what they do, and their expenses.
We don't know what magic enchants the cavern, nor do we know its purpose. All we know is that the chamber holds valuable clues to the city's mysterious past.
It all starts with actually capturing the hall. It costs just 100 gold. Now, some people when Heart of Thorns came out complained that this was too high, but let me tell you this is an utter pittance to consider, particularly with in-game inflation and economy levels. The problem here comes from people thinking in terms, as I mentioned earlier, of their own pocket rather than entire guilds. It's an issue that pervades most guild economy feedback you will find online. For some perspective on how small 100 gold is, even if you are one of the smallest little guilds out there and you have just 10 people in your guild, it would only cost you 10 gold a head to get the hall. Under the current economy, that means you could get a guild hall with a single 20 to 30 minute fractal run, which would get you that 10 gold, and you'd still have money to spare. Most guilds have way more than 10 players, and when you put this into perspective, I think we'll find that no one rightly flinches at that 100 gold price tag. The mission to capture the hall too also ended up fairly inconsequential, much like many other parts of the Guildhall system. I remember hearing the suggestion that it would be somehow like a raid, but I've never seen much challenge in this step of gaining a hall, and there have even been videos of people soloing it as long as they're on a character fast enough, like a thief or a warrior. That said, these missions are repeatable content when you swap halls, and it's kind of fun and rare and kooky enough that it probably was a worthwhile addition to Heart of Thorns. I'm not quite sure what more we could ask from the devs for this. It's not like this deserves to have raid rewards, and it's not like everyone who wants a guild hall has to be incredibly good at the game. Maybe the balance is just right. Before launch, it was explained that it would cost 100 gold to not only initially capture a hall, but it would also cost 100 gold to swap to any other guild hall you like after your initial acquisition. Again, 100 gold is almost nothing to established guilds, so this is unbelievable freedom. Further, the system is designed right now so that if you swap halls, it doesn't even reset your upgrading progress in restoring the various buildings and acquiring upgrades. ArenaNet have given the players an immense amount of freedom. While looking at first very good on paper, this part of the Guildhall system, in my personal opinion, is actually a bit of a shame and a missed opportunity. And I make that comment specifically with regards to when the next Guild Wars expansion comes out and the ones beyond there. See, what I anticipate to happen is when those new expansions release, players will exercise their freedom to instantly swap to another hall and instantly have all of the upgrades complete, and they will probably do so. It means that many people will flock away from the core Heart of Thorns halls and then move into whatever else ArenaNet designs for us. It means, though, that as long as the system stays as it currently stands, each Guild Wars 2 guild will only ever be allowed to experience building up a guild hall from a wreck to a wonderful place once lifetime. And to me, that's where most of the joy is in this entire system. Seeing entire buildings growing before your eyes and deep mines etching their way into what was once solid rock, being able to compare how your new badass guild looks compared to the dump that it was at first. Before Heart of Thorns came out, the developers suggested that when you built up buildings in your hall, these would be epic moments that guildies would gather together and watch, and the main Heart of Thorns trailer has a really exciting shot of this very thing happening. Unfortunately though, a lot of people miss out on when those upgrades occur, and they never get another reasonable opportunity to experience it. Really take the time to consider what this means for future guild halls down the line. ArenaNet are going to be asked to develop several versions of all the buildings within those new halls and several different areas of those new halls in various states of disrepair. They're going to have to build a field that doesn't have a mine in it, and then they're going to have to build a version of that field where it's got a bit of a mine, and then a bit more of a mine, and then a deeper mine, and then a fully finished mine, and they're going to do arena areas where it's all in disrepair, and then slowly a building appears, and then a tent appears to do construction on it as they slowly grow and grow and grow. But realistically speaking, all the players are going to do when this guild hall comes into the game is bypass all those different states of disrepair, and it's wasted dev time. One thing you might be thinking is, are these upgrade moments really so good that this is a big deal? They weren't that great to me. And maybe there is a little truth to this. While ArenaNet got most of the way to infusing joy into these epic moments where buildings are constructed, I feel like the fact they forced them into cutscenes on us was a big mistake. If instead of these special events being in cutscenes, we were free to watch them slowly unfold before our eyes over the course of 5 to 10 minutes during regular gameplay as guildies gather around and look on in awe, it would have been so much better. But cutscenes are none, There are also Guildhall NPCs to consider. Not only does triggering upgrades affect the landscape, but it also prompts dialogue out of several unique NPCs who have come to the hall that have got voice acting and interesting things to say. Under the current system, when a new expansion rolls around, nearly all of that content too is going to get skipped by the vast majority of the player base and be unseen forevermore, despite the fact that those NPCs are actually some of the more fun ones that the devs put into Heart of Thorns. I was very proud of my ability to document and record every line of dialogue these characters speak as I built up my guild, so imagine the gut punch later when the hard drive containing all of that footage broke for me, and I knew I'd never have another reasonable chance to see what these NPCs say because we only get to do progression once. You might make the argument that, actually, new guilds are likely to form with the new expansion, and those new guilds will at least experience all of this cool content, but I'd suggest that many new players are likely to find themselves in pre-existing max level guilds, and this is still going to be a very rare occurrence. And neither does this address the fact that a vast majority of the installed user base is still going to be missing out. And this isn't just a problem for future expansions, it's a problem right now. Guilds who initially chose the Lost Precipice will never know what it feels like to upgrade the Gilded Hallow, or truly understand what the further exploration perk actually unlocked in the Gilded Hallow, and vice versa, even if these guilds do later become more attached to the opposite hall and will feel at home there. Much of the flavor dialogue that these NPCs comment on during these epic moments hasn't been documented online for nearly a whole year, because it just happens once and then it's gone for good. My solution would be something of a middle ground on this. I would recommend that we have the initial 9 month or so progression be exactly the same as it currently is for all guilds, and keep that very low price tag of 100 gold to swap halls, but then I would say that if a guild swaps, their progress should be reset. All the buildings should be destroyed so that your guild can enjoy going through that progression again, witnessing the many restorations and NPC dialogue. However, and very importantly, on your second time through, I would propose two key differences. Number one, that despite the fact your new hall after you've made the swap is visually in ruins, I would say you should never lose essential services that you'd already worked for in an earlier time, particularly those available from the war room, for example, in the marketplace, so that world versus world based guilds don't feel punished for swapping halls. And second, I would say that your second progression through the hall should be a lot faster than the last time. So now, instead of taking 9 months, maybe it should only take one or two instead, and way less currencies. These looser requirements would give guilds still a lot of freedom to swap around, it would do what ArenaNet's trying to encourage, but it wouldn't completely gut this entire area of the game from what is fun about it. I really think that without a change like this, it doesn't matter how many new guild halls ArenaNet add in future expansions, they're never going to be as interesting as they otherwise could have been. Moving away from the idea of building up your guild hall, let's look at the upgrades themselves and the currencies we use to buy them. Really, there are three systems to know about. First is the guild treasury, second is something called Ethereum, and third, we have favor. Those of you who followed Heart of Thorns very closely before it was released might remember a lot of very confusing details about Guildhall's many currencies, and since that time, it's mostly diluted down to just these three things. The devs have streamlined stuff significantly and to great effect. This has been an excellent change. First, you have influence. This is the classic Guild Wars 2 currency that was very much ill thought out and poorly handled, and this has mostly been removed and has little use anymore. Influence is something that 2012 players will be more familiar with than any player of Guild Wars 2 here in 2017. Though some guilds still do hoard a little bit of influence just for fun, it doesn't really do much more than spawn an extra NPC at your hall who's trying to trade for the stuff. Next, you have Resonance. Resonance was another currency that now is no longer in the game. It had very little use and only right at the start of Heart of Thorns. The idea was that the guildies who played together might be able to earn resonance, and you could use resonance to turbocharge the production of various guild wares like decorations or world versus world stuff. It had a very short run before the developers decided that it was totally unnecessary, but because of its very brief tenure in the game, it still bloats some areas of the user interface. For example, and very weirdly, there's still a guild permission for resonance, and it still appears on the assembly device where guild items are created, even though it's basically not a thing at all. Some players might still have some items relating to resonance too. My opinion of both Ethereum and Favor, the only two currencies still in the game, are that they're excellent currencies. Some people will dispute this because these are both time-gated currencies, which can look like a very cheap tactic to artificially lengthen the people's playtime, but I believe that the guild system needs this kind of gating. It helps the importance of each big upgrade shine as there's some waiting for the next one to come in, and it allows smaller guilds to grow at roughly the same speed as the bigger guilds, those that are maybe 50 times their size. And this time gating allows people to gather materials for upgrades at a much more casual pace than they otherwise might feel they need to. Ethereum is a mineral in the rocks that you get out of the mine at your hall. After you establish a mine, which is one of the first constructs you'll ever do, the workers there will constantly haul Ethereum out of the mine, and you can trade it for construction of everything else. Ethereum is basically the rocks you build everything with. It's a perfect and steady currency that continues trickling in at a defined rate, and it's the most blatant time gate that dictates everything else you do in the guilds. There's a little further play to Ethereum too. At first, you only have a maximum amount of storage for the stuff, which isn't enough to get your guild through most of the bigger and tougher construction projects that will come on your doorstep later on. So not only do you have to invest in the mine, but you should continually reinvest in increasing its capacity. You'll also be presented with several opportunities to increase the mining speed of your workers, just very lightly touching into RTS territory, and it's quite fun. So if your guild is having no problem at getting all the other items and money together and are just waiting on these rocks to come in, you can pick up those speed upgrades faster. These are concepts I really like playing with. Particularly early on in the hall, I loved this part of Guildhall progression that most people don't get to see. I loved that question of, do I make a whole new building today, or should I increase my mining speed and get that new building faster next week? My adventure through the system was making all the decisions totally solo, but I think if you were in a guild where you had a group of officers maintaining a community, you could have a lot of fun discussing what to do with your friends and coming to collective decisions together. Unfortunately, however, the system after these early days kind of runs out of steam very quickly because of a weird design decision. See, each building that ArenaNet put in the game has several upgrade tiers, and they're banded together. So going up a tier is when the big visual changes happen in the hall, such as the mine getting deeper or a tent being erected and so on. To go up a tier, you are required to unlock everything that's available so far, otherwise you're stuck. And that's the kind of weird thing. It means that quite often, there's no fun decision making to have anymore. Maybe I don't actually care about getting mining speed right now, but the system is forcing it on me because I can't go up a tier and get the thing I really want unless I get this other upgrade first. I never did appreciate this, and steadily, this means that the deeper into Guildhall progression you go, the less interesting the decisions become, because it just becomes a matter of filling out everything on the spreadsheet. Not great. I also think it's unfortunate how few visual differences there were at many of the locations around the hall. I understand that it probably takes a lot of scripting and environment art being hooked up to make this stuff look as great as it is, but the game boils down to showing you pretty much three different states of each building and that's it. There's what a building looks like before anyone was there at all, when it's in absolute disrepair. Then there's what it looks like when it's under construction, and then there's finally what it looks like when you're finished. There's just those three states. This means that the vast majority of upgrades that you're purchasing as you go through Guildhall progression don't mean anything visually. You're probably just getting these upgrades again to move up another tier, and that's that. Ethereum production can be a bit wonky moving to the later stages of guild progression too. And that's because of how expensive things get. See, very early on in the hall, Ethereum moves very slowly, and the guild has plenty of time to gather other materials for relatively cheap upgrades, and you're constantly waiting on these rocks to come in. Later on, however, the reverse becomes true. Ethereum is now flowing really fast, but the upgrades are costing hundreds and hundreds of gold to acquire each, and players have to farm like mad just to keep up, so you always have more than enough Ethereum. Ethereum goes from being the main mechanic of interest to the one of least interest because you always have enough. Weirder still, ArenaNet bundled two hyper-expensive mining speed upgrades at the very end of the mine upgrade tree. But because of what I just mentioned, Ethereum has long ago ceased to be a concern, and buying those last mining upgrades for such a tall price is incredibly unrewarding. You don't need them. It's just about as bad as it gets. Favor, Ethereum's brother, is a much more consistent currency in how it plays out. Simply put, favor is this. The more you help out the Guild Initiative in Lion's Arch through completing missions every week, the more favor you get. You can then spend that favor to encourage the initiative workers to build you things in the hall. Every upgrade you get will ask for both Ethereum, the rocks, and favor. Favor is time-gated too, because you can only do so many missions each week, but if you try and do as many missions as possible, and as you level up, you unlock more slots for missions, you can kind of mess with how fast you get it, a bit better than Ethereum. Favor was single-handedly the only reason I wanted to run guild missions after Heart of Thorns released, and as soon as it was apparent that we had enough favor, I stopped running guild missions. This is probably because one of the main perks of guild missions, some of the ascended gear in the game, most players now already have, myself included, or we're bypassing acquisition of it through things like berries in the New Living World maps, and we don't care about guild commendations. To this end, and the fact I feel players should want to run guild missions, I think favor's an excellent currency, encouraging players to actually do an area of content. The problem is that once your community has gone through Guildhall progression once, you never care about favor again, and all of that incentive kind of drops away. This is an interesting balance to watch as you build a Guildhall, by the way, taking note of which currency holds you back more, Ethereum or favor. I think generally, because favor is something you don't always get with no effort, it continued to be a focus for me a lot longer than Ethereum was, and I like the place that it has. The feeling that everyone was working together on a guild mission for the direct benefit of the hall was a great feeling I will now miss now that our progression is complete. You don't get that same sense of camaraderie at guild missions that we once upon a time did. Unlike Ethereum, which becomes completely useless once you finish your hall, favor does have some purpose at the end, and interestingly it relates to the headquarters back in Lion's Arch. Place here is a single NPC who will allow you to spend large quantities of favor for certain upgrades like world boss consumables, and this guy ensures that the currency will always have a purpose. That gets top points from me. It's almost certainly not by intelligent design, but particularly I've enjoyed that weird feeling of starting off your entire adventure with the guild halls at the headquarters where you schedule that initial expedition, then you leave the headquarters for ages and ages and ages, and finally you return at the very, very end when you have no other uses for favor. That was kind of fun in a weird way. The last thing to discuss about all of this is the treasury. The treasury could use a lot of work. This is the guild inventory system. It's a place that guildies can deposit all of their items into, and then those items can be spent at buildings whenever they're needed. So for example, let's say we want to upgrade the mine. The mine might want some Ethereum, which you've already got. It might want some favor, which you've already got because you just ran a guild mission for it. But now the mine also wants 50 pickaxes for the workers there. And at this point, players have to work together to donate those pickaxes as items into the treasury before the upgrade can go through. The treasury is where your average Guild Wars 2 player, who's not an officer or a leader in charge of big decisions at the guild hall, will find themselves spending money on guilds. I have no problems with the treasury in principle, but its implementation leaves a lot to be desired. First, there's no easy way for a player to know what items what buildings want, and there's no easy way for guild leaders and officers to clearly show their communities what they're working on without having to physically travel around to various waypoints and ping things. That's annoying because it means that if you want to contribute to your guild, you have to go through multiple loading screens in and out and around the hall and to a trading post and somewhere else in the world to 1. Figure out what's needed, 2. Buy the stuff, 3. Pick up the stuff, and 4. Finally get to the treasury to drop it off. This alone is enough to put a lot of regular players off from donating to their guild halls, let alone the fact that you don't get any personal reward for doing it, or easy way of seeing who's contributed how much and what and when. As a guild leader, I ended up asking people not to donate directly to the treasury, but to me directly, so that I could process what they'd done and people would get due credit. There are a lot of people who donated to my treasury that I don't even know when they did it or how much they spent, and it's a totally thankless gesture because the treasury isn't designed in such a way that I can easily see who's given what. That kind of sucks. I'm usually not a big fan of ideas like this, but I really think anyone should be able to donate to the treasury and see what buildings are asking for from anywhere in the world, directly right there in the guild window. This does take a little bit of the immersion away of having to travel to your guild to help it out, but it would remove a huge amount of the headache if people knew at any point they can help their guild out right there by pressing G and being done with it. Moving on, let's talk about one of the most important and cool perks that you get in guild halls, and that comes right towards the end of your progression. It's further exploration. I already mentioned a little bit about this, but further exploration is kind of the other big thing that will visually change your hall outside of the individual buildings. See, when you first arrive at your guild hall, there are various places you absolutely cannot access unless you use decoration tricks to sort of sneak your way around. Right towards the end of your progression, you can get further exploration that unlocks these places, including an entirely new waypoint, and it is freaking awesome. I love further exploration, and I would love to see that future guild halls that the devs put in do more of this. Further exploration is one of the coolest parts of guild hall progression you can experience, and I just regret that, again, more people don't really get to experience what the hall is like before further exploration, and then again, what it's like afterwards, because most established communities out there right now unlocked further exploration bloody ages ago. Earlier in the video, I explained that despite all of this aforementioned stuff, all these features and things that have come into guilds, guild halls are not really visited much and haven't been a big game changer for Guild Wars 2. A lot of people will say that a trading post and a bank at the hall is all that they really need to be fixed, and this largely comes from those of us who enjoy scribing and those who are frustrated with the treasury. But this, in my opinion, is kind of nonsense. First, you already do have a bank at the guild hall. It's at the scribing station. And second, the trading post wouldn't help that much. Remember, I've personally made every single decoration in the game. That's a lot of dipping in and out of the guild hall for a trading post. But even with that experience under my belt, I don't think having a TP in the hall is necessary. Having a trading post would only be a minor boon. It'd have to be right next to the scribing station to be a bigger one for the most of us. And even then, it's just going to encourage people to stand in that one tiny area of the hall even more, and not much else. What about all these other vast and unexplored depths of the halls that people still don't go to? No, I think that guild halls, in order to be visited more and start to shine more, really need to be recognized as something almost in a different genre to the rest of Guild Wars 2. These are highly social, almost sandbox modes of play. I say give each area of the game its distinct role. There is a pretty common argument out there that guild halls are by design not supposed to be visited very much. And this is because the developers don't want everyone squirreled away in little instances hid away from each other, kind of like we had in the first game, but instead they want you in the open world and they want you in the city so that the game will feel as populated as possible. While I do think that that's a very real concern for Guild Wars 2 that we should pay attention to, I don't think that that also makes the guild halls crappy by design. I seriously doubt the devs went in a room and said, yeah, let's make this area subpar because we want our game to feel populated. I think you can have your cake and eat it too. I think you can give people 20 to 40 minutes of meaningful gameplay a day in a guild hall before they then want to leave and go do other stuff around Core Tyria, and we're somewhere in the sweet spot. In general, I would say that guild halls and the guild hall team could learn a lot by looking at other games that play into what the guild halls are trying to be. Games like Stardew Valley or Animal Crossing and Harvest Moon. These are games that all express very well the same kinds of things that I think guild halls are trying to. They present small spaces, worlds that you can frequently return to, and it always feels like something's happening or changing. But it's brief and casual play, where with a little bit of time every day, you can make an impact as things are evolving around you. And then you move on. Guild halls slide perfectly into these ideas. There's a reason why people have so often requested being able to water their potted plant decorations and actually watch them grow in Guild Wars 2, is because this fits in so well to the apparent vision for Guild Hall content. But the space of the game needs a lot of TLC to get anywhere remotely there. So what do? Currently, there are very few reasons anyone would ever go to their hall. First, scribing being exclusive to the hall workshop makes it probably the most visited of all places. Scribes cannot make only decorations, but also World vs. World specific things as well, as some very basic consumables for PvE. Before the launch of Heart of Thorns, ArenaNet gave the impression of guilds out battling in the Mist Wars or doing events, while their scribes are scribbling away and working from the home base to keep them supplied. And to some extent, I think that they got that right. Since you can't do it anywhere else in the game, I'd say the workshop has been very well implemented and gets plenty of use. Secondly, you have decorating. Decorating is unfortunately very much held back by something known as global cap, which restricts the total number of decorations that can be placed in a hall, as well as local cap, which restricts the total number into a small area. Before the launch of Heart of Thorns, we were explicitly told these limits were not likely to affect any players, but in truth they affect even the most casual of decorators on a day-to-day basis, almost killing the system. I have included a discussion about these things in a more appropriate place, my scribing video in this series, which you can dive into on the playlist if you'd like. Likely, the largest reason to visit the hall for a non-scribe and a non-decorator is to gather from a selection of synthesizer nodes outside one of the buildings each day. It's not any gameplay, really, it's just a 3-minute walk to a location before pressing F a few times and leaving. So it's quite sad that this is the best that the halls have. But that said, it is an easy way to earn a bit of money, and quite often at reset, when the nodes respawn, you'll see a steady train of people heading there. This is a powerful thing, as it offers chances for guildies to interact with one another, and also for them to be excited at any potential decorations in the area that may have changed, or other things they might not have noticed. In a perfect world, that then makes them want to stay in the hall after they've gathered and then decorate for themselves, maybe fund the treasury for future upgrades, or even pick up scribing for themselves. The unfortunate thing about all of this comes in two parts. Like so many other areas of the hall, this gathering thing is something you only really start to get a lot of benefit from after the respective building is fully upgraded. This is an expensive and time-consuming process that I'd wager means some guilds still haven't completed it, even 1 year down the line. Adding insult to injury is that, while thematically appropriate, the upgrade items the building asks for are those very same materials that you're going to be trying to farm in the first place. And number two, ArenaNet rather uncreatively just dropped the synthesizers in one location in the hall right near the building. While convenient, this means that all that people will ever do in a guild hall is tread that same little path every day from the same nearby waypoint. For a lot of guilds, particularly those very low on decorations or who do not want to wipe their halls and decorate anew with any frequency, that whole element of the guild changing around them is non-existent. My suggestion, therefore, would be that the location that these nodes spawn in that you can gather from should be spread out in a variety of random locations that changes daily. The number of materials dropped by the nodes can be dramatically increased to offset the added effort necessary to run around the hall and get them, but also because, as we've seen with the new daily system, that a little more incentive on a once a day gate can be a very powerful thing. Think about how populated daily jumping puzzles are now just because of a 2 gold incentive. These new locations would be marked very clearly on the map, so it's not frustrating needle in the haystack game, but now, instead, players every day when they log into Guild Wars 2 get to do a different journey through their guild hall. Suddenly it feels rewarding for those of us who enjoy decorating to put decorations off the beaten track, because people might actually see them out there because they have incentive to run around the whole hall. The immense space of the hall is put to use. People are using different waypoints, they're spending longer there, they're feeling more rewarded, and some of that dynamism that ArenaNet sought to catch with the halls has actually been introduced. Another potential reason for players to visit their guild hall is to use the guild portal. This feature, in theory, allows large guild squads to unite at the hall before opening a portal to anywhere else in the game world. Again, like with the synthesizers, this gets people interacting and playing around and is generally a desirable thing. However, in my entire time playing Guild Wars 2, I've never actually worthwhile used that portal. I don't doubt that it is used by some guilds, but it's nothing crucial or very interesting to the game. And this comes down to several factors. First, a benefit of this portal should be that you can avoid waypoint fees, right? As you can travel to the hall for free and then you can go through the portal anywhere you like. But despite massive amounts of gold inflation and the introduction of stuff like 2 gold for dailies, ArenaNet have never adjusted waypoint fees in the history of Guild Wars 2. So it's not really a gold sink anyone ever thinks about. The consequence of this is that only the absolute most frugal and anal of players will ever care about the monetary aspect of using the guild portal. Reason number 2 is that it's simply far easier to just click a waypoint in chat and go to the location of your guild event like that. Are you doing a mission together? Are you about to kill a world boss together? Are you going for a world versus world raid? Are you going for a PvP night? Whatever you're doing, it's easier to press M and just waypoint directly there than to hit the double loading screens of using the portal by going through the hall. And thirdly, the portal just has very few selectable locations, nor does it have any exclusive destinations to go to either. The portal could be offering access to activities for guilds to play in, or other places like the Halloween Labyrinth, or more, but it doesn't. A lot of what guilds do together might be current events content, such as hunting bloodstone creatures or anomalies in the world, and the portal won't help you much there either. The best that the Guildhall portal will do is get you to Lion's Arch, which you could have done for free anyway through Heart of the Mists or something. The Heart of the Mists destination particularly is stupid for the Guildhall portal, since you can always access that for free by just pressing the PvP window. And beyond that, you can queue anywhere in the world now as well. You don't even need to go there. So as it stands, the Guildhall portal is a very useless upgrade. The idea of everyone meeting in the hall before heading out on an adventure is something I very much like, but without changes, this just isn't going to be happening without arbitrary enforcement on the part of guild leaders and officers. My suggestions would be to, I don't know, perhaps readdress waypoint fees to make this method of transport actually applicable to the game, maybe offer more control over destinations, perhaps offer exclusive destinations such as activity queuing, or, and perhaps most effectively, maybe we should enable the guild to only pop one special portal each day, and if anyone uses that within a reasonable duration, they can get magic find or gold find or karma gain, and that would reward players in whatever content they're about to go off and experience to go to the portal before they do it. And because it's a once per day activation, it encourages everyone to bundle up together for that specific moment. The next reason players might visit the hall would be to use the guild arena, which can be a very effective way of retaining people, and was probably one of the most exciting aspects of Heart of Thorns, I thought, before it came out. And the arena has actually delivered on some of its pre-release hype. I've spent a great deal of time prototyping and hosting events that take place in the Guildhall arena, and the places I'd like to see improvements here are numerous. For now, I'll settle by keeping it short, and simply saying, the arenas are prohibitively small, and the guild team has unnecessarily stifled player creativity with them. For example, the Lost Precipice has an excellent pool of water beneath its arena that I would love to do some simple, stupid underwater fighting in. This would be possible, except the fact that the dev team never made it legal fighting space despite the fact that it's so nearby. The same goes for the large swathes of airspace above the arena. These could be an awesome place to build large towers to fight over, but again, the space for fighting has been restrictively placed at a very, very, very small bubble. Before the release of Heart of Thorns, the big world versus world guilds were assured that a very big Guildhall arena map was on its way that they could do their GVGs in, and that hasn't manifested at all. Also to think about are the arena decorations. These, too, could be really cool, but they're also incredibly restrictive in their usage. The arena does have some amazing additions like the kill floors, but for some reason, why are we not allowed to place them anywhere except on the very floor of the arena? Do you want to put a kill floor on a ramp or a wall or floating somewhere to create an interesting and weird trap? Well, you're not allowed. Tough luck. Some of the other traps are interesting, but they also can't be scaled in their potency, so fall completely flat. So, do you want to make use of that lightning strike turret? It sounds good, doesn't it? Well, good luck, because it does basically no damage and is of no consequence, and you have no way of tuning it. Interestingly, if you enter this arena with random low-level characters that aren't level 80, like go to your guild hall on a level 30 toon, or a 40, or a 50, or a 60, you'll suddenly find those traps become more or less deadly, and now they have a ton of play. Regeneration turrets, when you're playing on a really low-level character, can create specific areas of near-player invulnerability that they're so strong. Lightning strike turrets can become instant kills. Poison turrets can drain health at an incredible rate. These are all really fun to play with, but it's utterly impractical to request players to join your arena event at the guild hall at exactly level 40 and to not be a level lower or a level higher, otherwise they're going to be disqualified. One solution to this might be to force arena participants to a certain level range, as we see in the open world, but apparently the devs didn't consider this. If we had the power to determine stuff like that, the Guildhall arena would be so much cooler. Similarly, there's no way to enforce builds and weapons on people so that you could run special player-made game types. Instead, we have to rely on honor rules and hoping that people won't cheat. Not only is there no way to specify builds in the arena, but there's no way to even check them like we can, say, in structured PvP. The result of this, and many more things, is that the arena is rarely good for something much more than very small scrims between friends and really casual game types. The green team, the invulnerable team, the free-for-all method, the decorating team are all things that could make the arena really distinct from competitive PvP, and they do see some small use, but are nowhere near their potential, and it's such a damn shame. My solutions would be to expand the playable space, release the restrictions on the placement of arena decorations, and invest in systems that allow players to assign builds and level ranges to one another. Perhaps the last of this could be done as an extension of a build template system, if one's ever added. With those changes, the arenas would be far, far, far more fun, and we'd have a lot of crazy events and game types spawn. Almost infinite replayability. I seriously stand by that. But for whatever sad reason, addressing the arena does not seem to be a priority. I just hope they get it right on the next expansion. Further to consider are the PvP only players and their incentive to visit the hall. Currently, the game does allow you to queue into PvP matches from anywhere in the world, which is really good for guild halls, but it always dumps players back into the Heart of the Mist instead of back into the hall. If instead PvP players were put back in their guild halls, where they were last stood, like in the arena, I think you'd see a lot of PvP players who queue for competitive games, and while they're queuing, actually have fun scrims with random players of their communities and so forth while they're doing their matchmaking. But again, even that doesn't happen. Moving away from the arena, the tavern is another one of the buildings in the guild hall that serves as a potential reason for players to return here, albeit it's a very small one. It always struck me that the tavern was more of a ceremonial location that guildies could meet up in to talk to one another and have a drink, shall we say, even if realistically that wasn't being supported by the game. Nonetheless, there is a system whereby players can buy a unique buff that enhances one of their stats every 24 hours. So you can get faster reward track speed, you can get magic find or karma gain or bonus speed and so on. It's tuned to last for exactly a day of playtime. Not real world time, but playtime. So that means you have an incentive to go to your guild hall, guys. You'll be stopping once by every 24 hours of in-game time, and not much more. That's all you're really getting on this one. Aside from selecting the anthem or hall music here, there is nothing much else to do. I would suggest that if the guild tavern is supposed to be the social place, players should have more opportunities to interact with one another there. Maybe we should have free and infinite Belcher's Bluff games. People should be able to play that Golem chess mini game from Metrica Province or Rock, Paper, Scissors with one another. The Black Lion aesthetic vendor could be here to let players mess with their appearance while waiting for friends to talk and show up. Witches' cauldrons and boxes of funds should be spawnable from an NPC in the tavern. Buying everyone a round of drinks. You can have instruments that are only available in the gem store that can be played and previewed only in the tavern. Hell, that would drive sales for those instruments so people can do it elsewhere in the world. Perhaps outfits could be playtested here. What about rarely discounted metabolic primers that only trigger once a certain player threshold is hit in the tavern, similar to the old World versus World breakout event mechanics? Without specific reason to visit the tavern is exactly like the rest of the guild hall in terms of being an arbitrary meeting spot. It's pretty and interesting, but it's not at all what some of the pre-release discussion may have suggested. Two other locations in the hall really are quite dead and uninteresting in terms of replayability. First is the mine, which offers no content whatsoever, and second is the war room, which houses a single NPC that only the World versus World players will use. The mine is particularly disappointing, as it's the place that undergoes the most dramatic visual differences in the entire hall. So having players return there a lot would be cool, as they can revel in how different the place is as their hall is upgraded. It's also, in both guild halls, the least central location, so if there was something to do at the mine, at least a bit more of the space of the hall would be better utilized, as people have to run all the way over to it. Ambient dialogue from the NPC there is very easy to miss, and very few of us ever listen to, and exploring can be very unrewarding, as you don't know what's changed. The war room houses a single NPC who will offer badges of tribute for badges of honor, which the guild scribes can then turn into useful things. I have no problem with the war room being only relevant for world versus worlders, and I even like the setup here, but we're already dealing with a very thin slice of the player base who has reason to come to this part of guild halls. Add to this the fact that most players in a world versus world guild probably aren't spending their badges on this and just letting a few individuals front most of the cost, a reality that affects all forms of crowdfunding, both in Guild Wars 2 and out, and you'll soon find that the war room is hardly touched. Worse, visiting a place purely to buy a single item with a single common currency from a single NPC is about the most bland, flavorless, and shallow reason I think you can have to do something in a video game. And that's what the war room's got. ArenaNet have quite deliberately not enabled the purchase of these items from anywhere else to enforce the war room to be played, which I'm totally on board with and understand, but it's such an empty process. It feels like more of a dick move than anything else. My suggestion to improve both of these areas is not as easy to resolve as the rest of the other systems, but bluntly, I think that these places should just have actual content. Allow players to do mining of their own for a small Ethereum boost, or motivate workers who have grown lazy for favor. Help the Guild Initiative pour over their maps of the mists for war. Give people the opportunity to haul rocks, catch debris with buckets, sift for Ethereum using special action hotkeys, and so on. Particularly for the mine, I find the new renewable hearts concept first exhibited in Rising Flames to be a perfect fit for guild halls. Daily hearts. Think about it. Daily hearts with interesting non-combat sub-objectives, read not just mindlessly pressing F on stuff, which is what a lot of the hearts in the game have ended up being. Daily hearts could integrate really well into guild halls, and this is exactly the kind of thing that I think can make your decision between the Gilded Hollow or the Lost Precipice or any other future hall feel really distinct, because different halls can have different hearts and different things to do them. And it's not just with the mine or the war room you can put hearts. Both halls are vast areas with huge amounts of space with just nothing going on. Let's have some of these awesome Guild Initiative NPCs get involved with such hearts, doing more than just standing around and waiting for treasury upgrades, then nothing at all after progression's complete. If you can't picture daily hearts in the halls being implemented in a fun way at all, I'll also draw your attention back to guild missions. A new selection of these has felt long overdue for Guild Wars 2, but what about introducing some non-combat guild missions that hook into the guild halls? If not bounties, there can be guild treks, or even an entirely new category of guild mission based on that scanning radar minigame we saw in current events. Particularly, I like the current events idea, as here we have ArenaNet demonstrating a lot of truly emergent and random design in their content and pulling it off in a way that would be very fitting for a guild hall. Imagine 60 guildies running wildly off in all directions of the rarely visited sections of a guild hall, searching for items and bumping into decorations as they go in order to complete a guild mission. More opportunities for appropriate guild hall content might be found in the daily system too. In Living World Season 3, the devs have started doing special daily categories designed around specific maps. Well, why not give guild halls their own categories too, which reward players with tenebrous or shimmering crystals for completing simple tasks like running around between NPCs at the mine or the war room or anywhere else and placing decorations or scribing and so forth. To return to the current situation, finally, there is one more reason players might visit their halls, and that is to visit the marketplace. This is, in my opinion, the diamond in the rough of the guild system. It's a tiny shred of what could have been an incredibly powerful idea that just needs to be played into. In terms of replayability, there is a reasonable amount of stuff for everyone to do at the marketplace. First are the highly priced prestige minis that you can get only in the guild halls. They cost large amounts of gold, crystalline ore, and guild commendations, which are only available from that one NPC. With things like this, there will always be those that complain that the minis aren't easy enough to get, but as many of my subscribers will already know, my opinion tends to be that the harder it is to get, the better you feel when you have it, and the more proud you are showing it to other people. The minis maybe aren't the best looking things in the game, and the game doesn't reward you for collecting the full set through a collection, but it's a really good start. If only ArenaNet had added a collection with the final reward and maybe a badass title, it would have been a great part of the guild system. Second, you've got the armor and weapon vendors. Honestly, I'd consider the acquisition of some of these items a little too complicated and expensive, and it never really appealed to me that much, but with collections for the Tenebrous weapons, they would be probably in a much better place. Thirdly, at the marketplace, you've got the basic decoration vendor, who provides a range of very simple and cheap decorations for guilds to play with in their early stages. Quite cleverly, ArenaNet designed many high-level decorations to be built out of these low-level ones from this specific vendor. So this is a very commonly visited merchant for both scribes and non-scribes who are looking to just buy some stuff and have fun. It's not without its issues, as sadly, without having the marketplace upgraded, you can't access very many decorations at all, and this really limits what you can do in your early days in the hall and probably jades you to how great decorations are, but that's also how much scribes can do to start off. My suggestion here would be to change the vendor to have any of his wares that are built into other things by scribes be available right away. Then on the first decoration upgrade, have the rest added in, and the later upgrades simply be about reducing prices. Further, if we consider this vendor as your starter pack baseline guy for guild halls, which he is, you'll see that it's a shambles, that he only offers a measly, 15 items? It's important to foster enthusiasm for decoration and sandbox play in those early days without it all being locked off by massive upgrade and scribing costs. So I really think that this vendor at the marketplace should have 50 or so decorations to choose from, and that's lowballing it. They can be simple things, but they should be varied. If you don't understand how restrictive a lot of this is, at the launch of Heart of Thorns, most guilds were resorting to using pumpkins from the Halloween event to do their decorating just because they couldn't get anything else, which is ridiculous. Finally, we have one more NPC at the marketplace, simply entitled the Guild Trader, and this is where the magic happens. To be on the right page here, the way ArenaNet and the Guild Initiative have always spoken about the marketplace is that it's a constantly changing, exciting place filled with exotic and rare wares for sale. This isn't particularly true, as for every vendor I already spoke of, they have static inventories. This guy sells minis, this guy sells weapons, and that's it. But things are different with the Guild Trader. See, what's interesting about the Trader is that what's being sold shifts on a day-to-day basis, and sometimes the things that the Guild Trader offers are really quite good. Boxes of world versus world supplies, obsidian shards, rare gear, ascended recipes, and more are all available from this dude if you get lucky. These are bought for a single commendation each, which is pretty cheap, and also enough to be an excellent renewable sink for that currency. That is one of the very few reasons any of us have to stay involved with guild missions. Next, to stop the players from totally destroying economies when a particularly good deal appears at the trader, every guild member can only make 1 to 3 purchases on any one day, given on how much you've upgraded the marketplace. If you're trying to take advantage of some really amazing deal from the trader, you can only at most get 3 items from him. And then when the next day rolls around and you can buy more stuff, the wares will have changed to something new and you can't manipulate things too crazily. So this is the one place I would say that the developers did succeed in their vision of having a very renewable, dynamic guild hall and bustling marketplace idea. Most people will just visit their hall once a day to hit the synthesizers and leave, but the smarter one, who actually have been running guild missions, will visit the guild trader too, undeniably so. It actually works to get people in the hall, and as long as people know about it, it's being well utilized. Where the feature gets more interesting then is how ArenaNet incorporated scribing and decorations into the guild trader. See, there are a selection of decorations for the guild hall that the only way to get them is through that trader NPC. And this is what I've grown to love. The lattice, for example, can only be picked up on some days and then be built into 6 or 7 different other beautiful decorations like vined lattices, tall lattices, lattice archways, and loads of different varieties of flowered lattices. What makes this so fun is how this combines with the other restrictions in place of the Guild Trader. As a scribe and an enthusiastic decorator, I was desperate for my guild to have lots of these flowery decorations, but I couldn't do it alone. I, as an individual, could only buy at most 3 lattices per day, and that's if they were actually being sold. The result was that this became a guild drive. I talked to all of my community about them, and everyone started chipping in to do their part. People were talking to each other, they were visiting the hall, they were seeing how they could help. It galvanized the community, which is what guild halls should be doing. Even better, people started spending their commendations, and wondering when we could do more guild missions to get more, even more incentive for us to meet up and do things together. They were personally invested when those lattices were scribed by me into new pretty decorations, and they felt more connected to the progression of the guild, and this is even after all of the formal upgrade process had been completed. Unlike the building upgrade system, which has a definitive end, this system at the Guild Trader is almost endless. Every day, people would excitedly log in, head to the hall, and see what the trader was offering. My personal opinion is that one of the biggest improvements we could see to guild halls is more expansion on this system. Now, let me be clear, it's not without its problems. I've openly criticized this feature in the past, and for several reasons that do deserve resolving. My initial beef was that when you start out as a new scribe in a new hall, things can be really frustrating. You're presented with untold numbers of decorations you can maybe craft to higher levels and play with, but they all require ingredients that are impossible to access because you're only allowed to buy one per day, and you weren't lucky enough to have a trader selling it because your guild hasn't existed yet. And oh, guess what? You haven't even unlocked the ability to purchase them anyway, right? These are all valid frustrations. My suggestion, in addition to expanding heavily on the initial number of decorations people can play with up to 50 or so, would also be to hide these scribing recipes that require guild trader wares behind discoveries, so that new scribes aren't tricked into thinking they can make things they actually can't. There are definitely methods of leveling scribe without using the trader, so you can save people that frustration by hiding them. The next problem is, unfortunately, the wares themselves. As I said, I think the concept behind this is very strong, but ArenaNet haven't implemented the best options. Take the Resonating Sliver, for example. At the release of Heart of Thorns, the slivers were a valuable currency, and they may have made sense to have been sold from the guild trader. But no one in their right mind would buy those anymore. Who would spend a commendation on a Resonating Sliver when Resonating Slivers are worth nothing? Neither are they likely to spend their commendations on a tiny bag of crafting materials, or a single piece of crystalline ore, or a single bag of bloodstone. Dust. I appreciate that low value supplies and a somewhat random item list makes for a natural and wild fun NPC, so they do have their place, but there are just far too few useful items rotating in and out of the guild trader for it to have been as successful as it really could be. The solution's obvious. Add loads more stuff to this guild trader. Awesome rewards that appear really rarely and make it more exciting to visit him frequently. And some of this stuff just needs updating, that's all. Right now, there's a fairly small selection of decoration rewards available for purchase, but imagine if there were loads, and when the rarest and best of them at last comes up, the guild rallies around buying them. Another big problem with the system is, as it stands, how the decorations and guild-based wares are competing with personal wares. See, a player in your guild might really like to help you out by buying 3 wagons for the guild hall, but unfortunately, you're now finding that this player would much rather buy 3 large bags of obsidian shards for themselves instead. So they've chosen a personal reward instead of a guild-based rewards, and the two are competing. This happens all the time, and it kind of causes some animosity between people too. Players shouldn't have to choose between ascended recipes or whatever personal things they like and guild-based decorations. Why not separate the two into different traders? You know, the more traders, the better, I say. They don't have to be confined strictly to the marketplace either. They can visit your hall once you've upgraded the marketplace, but they could be anywhere. They could be placed in all sorts of underutilized locations around the hall. Just like the stuff I was talking about earlier, this encourages us to explore these massive, beautiful, empty maps. Particularly in the future, when there are a lot more guild halls, you could even have a system whereby the NPC is at, say, the Gilded Hallow on Monday, and then that NPC moves to the Lost Precipice on Tuesday, and it moves to Claw Island on Wednesday, and it moves beyond on Thursday, and so on. With enough different NPCs with different purposes moving around different halls, I think the halls could seriously grab at that Animal Crossing style gameplay I think we're all familiar with, and it makes that decision of what hall you go for that much cooler. And with that, I think we've discussed all the places where guild halls fell short, and all the places where guild halls still, in future expansions, with the right TLC, could be much improved. That is guilds. And maybe now you can see why, in general, they just didn't get pushed hard enough. That's why, to go back to the start of this video, I stand by my initial comment that really, guilds of Guild Wars 2 today don't feel too different to guilds of Guild Wars 2 before Heart of Thorns came out. Join me next time, guys, for a deep dive into the final thing to do with guilds, and that is scribing. A huge topic with massive amounts of things to talk about, especially in terms of the economy. Of course, do not be scared to skip the scribing video if you're not interested in all of this guild-based stuff, though I think I can offer some perspectives that most of the player base won't really understand, as not many of us have had the luxurious position of being able to be a scribe and crowdfunded by many other people. Thanks very much for watching, guys. Let me know whether you think this has lived up to their GW1 brothers and sisters from all those years ago we were all clawing for, and I will see you next time.
As you build out your guild hall, you and your guild members will be able to go on great adventures. You can organize to prepare for your guild missions, and to go into the jungle to face the incredible new challenges that await you. Seems like you guys might like that one a little bit.